Hey there, I'm Kay Hanley.
I'm Greg Barron.
And you're listening to Rock Out with Your Doc Out. On this week's episode, we will talk about As the Palaces Burn, the rockumentary by...
Lamb of God.
Yeah.
Lamb of God. It is an exploration of the band that turns into something quite different as the lead singer gets arrested for murder while
murder.
They're on tour.
Murder. Murder.
Yeah.
Murder.
Murder. That's right. So we were just talking again about the National.
We can't stop.
Can't stop. We were talking about how great their new record is. And then we were talking about why. We asked Rick if he had knew the National before. And he said, no, he hadn't because the documentary. And the documentary, we were just talking about the way it is sold on Netflix as get them to the Greek, right? Like they sell it like it's a comedy. And then the cover looks like a European buddy movie from the like 80s. Like it looks like Withnail and I or something. You're like,
wow.
I don't know what this cover is.
Wow, busting out the Withnail and I. Wow, that is digging deep. I applaud you, Greg.
Right.
But I also applaud me because clearly we both saw that. So, so that just means that we're great.
But what you just said is really true, which is like the title doesn't do them any favors for a thing that's been so considered. It's art direction, and it was so well made.
Yeah.
The description of it, the cover and the title don't lead you to anything.
They don't. Yeah. It just doesn't say what it is.
Yeah.
And then I was saying, and this might be in Letters to Cleo, we used to have this thing about naming songs. Giving titles to songs that where the title did not appear in the lyrics anywhere. We were just like, we have a song called Pizza Cutter and another one called Laudanum. And it's like these words do not appear in the song. And it's confusing to people. They don't know what the song is.
But here's the thing though. There was also 15 bands back then. So you had time to figure it out. Whereas now, if you don't tell somebody what something is, it just goes right by them.
And also
they don't have time
for
you to be obtuse, right?
Oh, no, you can't. I don't think you can. I think you have to say what it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for me, working at Disney and working, or writing music for scripts, I am forced to be, I'm used to being a very linear thinker when it comes to create. It has to say what it is. The title is the repetitive thing that happens in the hook, and then whatever you're sort of putting up there to picture, it has to match what's happening on screen. So it's like, I'm very aware now, and not that everybody has to be this way, obviously, but for me, it's like, I'm very aware of how the visual ties together with the lyric, ties together with the melody. And I think it's just helpful.
I totally agree. And I think, if you look at that documentary, it's hard to know what to call a documentary that's supposed to be about a band on tour and ends up being about two brothers. But it almost, if you were describing it to somebody at the party, you go, it's about the National, but it really is about the older brother and the younger brother and how the younger brother's a fuck up. That's how you would describe it. You know what I mean? So somewhere in the title, I guess it would be weird to call it, I always think my brother's somebody he's not. That could go both ways. I always think he's like this nice, benevolent guy, but he's actually just keeps me around because it makes him feel better. And we're both alcoholics. But he writes great songs, and I'm insane.
And I'm a terrible production assistant.
Right. Terrible. Right. And I never was going to be a good one. And who thought I was in the first place? You know me. You
God
gave me this
it.
Camera on purpose. We're all being manipulated by his wife.
Oh.
Who saw this as an opportunity.
Oh, so you think...
Maybe.
Now I know because of seeing them live... that the wife's name is Corinne.
Yes.
I didn't catch that.
She's a big part of the band.
She's a big part of the band.
Yeah. She's like Jim Gaffigan, the comedian's wife, is a comedian and writes a lot of his material with him and Karen's a big part of the songwriting process. Mm. Yeah. I wonder how the
we
rest
just
of
can't
the,
get
those are questions we didn't get to ask the rest of the band.
No, we didn't.
Oh, that's the next one. What about fucking Karen?
Corinne.
Corinne. There we go.
Corinne. Okay, listen. We saw a new rockumentary.
Yeah, well, it's...
You're going to describe it.
Yeah, it's from 2014. It is... it's called As the Palaces Burn. It originally sought to follow Lamb of God on tour. However, the story took a dramatic turn when the singer, Randy Blythe, was arrested on charges of manslaughter. What followed has left the world on the edge of their seats. So if you're on the edge of your seats right now because you haven't seen this, spoiler alert, we're going to ruin this for you. So yeah. If you want to go watch it, you know, pause and we'll still be here when you get back. But otherwise, spoiler alert, you're going to get off the edge of your seats. Hey, it's Greg. I'm going to be at the Irvine Improv this weekend, October, what is it, the 19th or the 19th, 20th, this weekend, Friday, after this is aired, then this weekend, if you're in Irvine, California.
Hey, this is Kay, and I have Letters to Cleo shows coming up in November. On November 16th, 17th, and 18th, we'll be at the Paradise playing all three of our albums, one each night. First night, Aurora Borealis. Second night, Wholesale Meats and Fish. Third night, Go. And it's going to be a blast. So there are bundles that you can buy at letterstocleo.net, or you can pick up your tickets at ticketmaster.com. See you there.
Hey, guys. If you have questions, suggestions, complaints, your own reviews, you can write us at rockoutwithyourdocout@gmail.com, and also iTunes us, right? Rate us.
Yeah, rate us and review us on iTunes. If you'd like to make any requests, you can do that at our Facebook page,
which That's
is
right.
just Rock Out With Your Doc Out,
yeah.
Or at Twitter. Greg is at Gregory Barrett, and
That's
I am
right.
at Kay Hanley, and we also have Twitter something or other,
we have a Rock Out.
Rock Out With Your Doc Out.
Rock Out With Your, at Rock
Twitter.
Out With Your Doc Out, and at Podcan.
Yeah.
And
so ask questions, make requests.
Lodge complaints, start a fight. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
We're into it. We can handle it. Did you have a good time at the Podfest?
I had a really good time at the Podfest. Did you have a good time at the Podfest? People, I feel like, flew in from all over the place. Comedy nerds of all shapes and sizes and colors and sexual orientations to
yes.
come see all the comedy.
Yeah.
Which I guess is those are the people that are sort of like commandeering the podcast format.
They're the reason there is a whole... they're the reason there is podcasting. Those
right.
people have been there before people were...
Right.
You know, they really like, especially with my old podcast, but I also was surprised at how many people I did not recognize in that room because I know most of our fans in some
right.
way. And so
and
I
they
was,
didn't know me. So
no,
they
I
were
think
your
they did.
Fans.
I think there were just some straight K fans there. I know there were because I know I stared into the eyes of people who are like, I don't really enjoy you as much as Kay. I didn't come here for you. Excuse me. Oh, I thought you wanted it. No, okay.
I was just surprised that there was anyone there. That was really cool.
For
and
having
how was
eight episodes of the show to have that place almost full? Like,
it was pretty cool
and super attentive.
Yeah,
and super
laughed
responsive.
In all the right places.
And it felt like that's where the show lives, like the ability to show clips.
Yeah, we need to figure out how to do that more and better.
Well,
I think Rick will help us with that. Will you help us with that, Rick?
I'm already on it.
But you know who needs to help us more is the listener, because if the listener gets excited and tells people, then we can come to where your town is, screen a movie, Kay can play some songs, we can do some stand-up, and then we can record a podcast. Like,
we can do it all.
Yeah.
We are a one-stop shop, Greg.
Yeah, we are. And I think also, if you're, if you are a filmmaker, or if you are making a documentary, or you want to, like, it would be, I don't think anybody owns that piece of property that is Rock Documentaries in terms of, like, oh, this is where we would take our movie if we were releasing it, or these are the people we want to have. We want to become those people, which means we probably have to be a little bit more opinionated about. What I did want to tell you is that in my ongoing continual love affair with The National, I saw The National last night at the Hollywood Bowl, but you...
I saw them at a private show as a fundraiser for the school that their child goes to, because my boss, Chris Nee, the creator of Doc McStuffins and EP of Vampirina, you know, she's like Disney Junior powerhouse, her son goes to this school, and so there are parents at the school, and The National played a private show for a fundraiser, and it was like, what did you think?
I liked them even more. I can't.
I know.
I couldn't. I was like, how am I? This is so weird, and I'm coming to it so late, and
me
I
too.
Know that. But I'm.
Who cares?
I think that guy, the singer, who I worry about, but I also
Why
love.
Why do you worry
about him? I don't know about your show, but last night he seemed a little tippled already, like already. Like, I'm not, that's not a judgment. It's just that thing of like, he admittedly was angry about politics, and he's like, this has been a shit year, but he was funny about it. And he does this song where he uses, like, he must use some of a Karl Rove speech, because he said, I will give him, if he admits to saying this stuff, I will give him the money. And he goes, but in 10 years, if he doesn't, I'm going to buy a house with it. So
great,
but yeah, I just found them really, again, just super compelling and real and interesting, and I just thought they pay off, and that's my first time seeing them. I hadn't seen them before that.
Right?
Have you?
No.
Did you?
I didn't even. I mean, as we talked about then, like, I wasn't even really a fan. I was a very peripheral acquaintance of the band, like at best.
Right, right, right.
And so for me, doing the Rock Out With Your Doc Out episode about their documentary, that was really my introduction to that. I didn't know what they looked like or anything. So, but then after we saw the movie, did the podcast, I just kind of like, they just stuck with me. And then the new record came out, Sleep Well Beast.
Yeah.
And I started listening to that, and I was just like, fuck, I love this band.
Yeah.
So when I went and saw them the other night at, you know, in this very intimate setting, their sound lends itself really well to intimate settings.
Yes.
It's very lush, which I didn't really associate with that band at all.
Right.
I think their sort of defining feature is Matt's very low, you know, sort of like alt crooner vocals.
Yeah. Half Lloyd Cole, half Nick Cave.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
And, so that is like the defining thing. But when you dig a little bit deeper, the sound is very lush, very complex, very emotional. And fuck, I love them.
Yeah, me too. I actually felt like the weird thing about the documentary, and it's interesting because last night they started, there's no one on stage, but they have cameras downstairs at the Greek or backstage. So you saw them in their dressing rooms, walking to the stage.
Oh, and you're, that's like, funny.
Oh my God, the brothers got to be, wait a minute, we're back at the movie. And then when they come out, you're like, I know you better than this. Why are all these people here with us? I spent all that time. I've seen the movie 3 times now. We're friends. This is too many people for this. I get that they all like it, but I wanted to have, I said
this
to Amira,
moment.
I go, the only thing that would make this better is if there were less people here and we were closer, because it doesn't feel like the band that opened for them, Local Natives, like, they really play it like
are
a rock
local
show.
Natives?
They are local, and they are in fact natives of Los Angeles.
Yeah, I feel like Cat Corbett has played them on Locals Only.
Yes,
on
they're
K-Rock.
Quite good. And but they play big like a rock band. Like, they play out, you know, like they move around and they project, and it's big, and it's actually better than their records. It's a big rock sound, and so they engage the whole building. Whereas, you know, he's singing into his gin glass. Like, he's just right there,
he's having an experience, he's having a moment to himself a lot of the time.
And there was just too much riffraff there for my friendship with him that I'm imagining,
it's
because,
like,
of the
where
documentary.
The fuck were those were they doing there?
Too many people. Yeah,
they were like stomping on your Matt buzz.
Yeah.
Yes. Did you see Tom?
I didn't see Tom, but I
didn't see Tom either.
I felt like
I was hoping
he should have been. I know I feel like he should be there. I feel like we should reach out to him. I think when we do our next, you know, when we figure out what
I
our next
round is. I can't believe no one that we know knows him and has, no one has told him.
He's, like I said, 7,000 people on his feed. I think he's knowable.
Do you follow him now?
I do, but he doesn't
tweet
ever. Yeah, he doesn't do it that much.
Who doesn't tweet? What kind of monster is he?
he's a monster. He is an absolute monster. We continue our love affair with that band.
Yes.
And I think more than any documentary so far, that's still my moment, like the one I liked the most.
Well, interesting segue.
Yeah.
Because I think we might have a competitor.
Interesting. I did not expect you to say that.
No.
So when we come back, Lamb of God, As the palaces burn.
Yeah. As the palaces burn.
Lamb of God is not a household name that everybody talks about, but at the same time, they're one of the biggest heavy metal bands around.
I never dreamed that we would be nominated for a Grammy or having the number two record in the country when we...
This type of music and with our fans, we evoke a very visceral, emotional response.
Metal has always been a very organic and honest outlet to get all those demons out.
When I hear Lamb of God, I hear many things that I think. I realize that I'm not alone, that I know it because of metal music.
There's this, always this feeling of breaking free that comes from this kind of music.
It's crazy. I fly around the world and get paid to scream.
I feel like they're gonna find out. I don't know who they are or what they're gonna find out, but they're gonna find out and it's all gonna be over.
I'm doing lousy, Brian. I got a singer in prison in Czech Republic charged with murder.
This kid's family, man. I need to know what happened. I want to look him in the eye, tell him.
Can you explain what stage diving means?
And what does it mean, mushing?
Can you explain why some witnesses characterized your behavior as aggressive?
Hopefully I'll never have to go back in there again.
It's not nice in there.
And it felt like the right thing to do to come back, even though it fucking sucks. Sometimes doing the right thing isn't the most comfortable thing.
I think one thing that people should know is that Greg and I do not talk about our feelings about the movie until we get in the room together. So
that's right.
I have no idea how you feel.
Right.
And you may have a little bit of prior knowledge about how I feel because I just kind of gave it away in the last segment. Lamb of God are a metal band. I don't know if metal really does it, but they're a speed metal band. What kind of,
I guess they sort of identify in the threat. Like it would be.
Kick drum metal.
Right.
Kick metal.
They've got they've got the Anthrax. They sound like Anthrax, but they have the Cookie Monster voice thing happening. Right. But there's a hint more melody than in the death metal stuff. So thrash metal, I think, because
okay,
they came from
sure,
punk.
Yeah,
I think
yeah.
that
they
feels right.
Punk,
they're in
right.
their 40s at this point, so they all sort of seem to identify.
Well, he was 40 when...
When
this was all going down,
right.
when this movie was being made. So they're from Richmond, Virginia.
Right.
And they all knew each other growing up.
Yeah, they appear to be kids that kind of grew up on the margins. At least the lead singer sort of alluded to the fact that he grew up, sort
of
an outsider.
On the wrong side of the tracks,
yeah.
maybe.
Yeah, on the wrong side of the tracks, kind of an outsider, kind of a guy who found his identity when he got into music.
Got into punk. He said that the Sex Pistols changed his life. He wears a lot of Misfits jerseys.
Yeah. Yeah, he's
a lifer.
He's a lifer for sure.
Yeah.
That guy wasn't going to do anything this way. Like,
yeah.
There are those people, I'm sure you've met them. Like, you're like, if there wasn't music, what would Steven Tyler do also if he hadn't been an Aerosmith?
True.
Right?
Yeah.
I saw him at the airport once in a huge hat, and I thought he was a woman for the longest time.
Wow.
I was like, oh, look at that woman.
He seems like a nice guy.
Seems like he's probably a lovely guy. No, I just literally was a gigantic hat, and he had his back to me, and he was super skinny, and I think he had a purse, and I was like, oh, there's a woman. And then he turned around. He, in fact, had a mustache, and I'm like, oh, my God, it's Steven Tyler. And I was still thrilled because it was Steven Tyler.
Yeah. There's a little Stevie Nicks and Steven Tyler.
Oh, yeah. There is. And there's also a little bit of my grandma, like just a little bit in that. A little bit. Is it like, because as you get older, that stuff looks less like you're doing that crossover, you know, young male wearing ladies' clothes. So like, oh, now you just sort of look like an older woman. You know, you look a little bit more like my grandma. The rest of the band for sure looks like my grandma's friends. Like, they for a long time.
So it's just like, so Aerosmith is just like a Mahjong game at this point. It says like
it is
Friday afternoon.
That's right. That's
gin
right.
and tonics.
Yeah.
Why are we talking about Aerosmith? We cannot stay focused. Okay.
Well,
Lamb of God.
Yeah.
So this movie begins with as it alludes, as it says in the description, the Netflix description, it starts off as just a tour documentary. They had just released their sixth album, Resolution. It debuted at number 3 on the Billboard charts.
Right, which is huge.
It was which
right,
is the, amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
number
that
one,
is a huge accomplishment, especially for a band like that. I never would have guessed.
Right.
And so they kick
Taylor
off
Swift
their tour.
Is number one at that point. So that's a lot of records, right?
Yeah, it's a lot of records. Yeah. I mean, not by, you know, 10 years ago, number 3 would have been, you know.
Right.
Meant something much different than it does now. But, yeah. You know, but number 3 means that you have a crap load of fans and
right.
that they are.
There's also many people stealing the record. There's also a lot of people spinning it on whatever services they bought. Like it's still.
Don't even get me started on that, Greg.
Yeah, right.
So they start, I think what they were trying to do was the footage that the places that they focused on for the filming of the beginning of the tour
right.
were places like Medellin, Colombia, Mumbai, you know, places
right.
that were a little under the radar and places where you wouldn't expect to see metal fans. And, you know, people traveled and, you know, these young metalheads traveled enormous distances to come see Lamb of God play at these enormous festivals and, you know, these outdoor places and huge like arenas and stuff. And I think what they were trying to illustrate was that like that this music is for the underdog and that it really speaks to people in these difficult circumstances.
Yes, that for a lot of folks that event is their form of rebellion or their
sure.
their time to like be able to like let out aggression. I think they were trying to establish themselves as being meaningful and having a purpose,
right?
So that if you were not a fan of their music or not, you know, which I did like just as a documentary watcher, if you are not a fan of this genre of music, it barely plays a part in the film,
right?
You know, you hear them play, but I think, given how long their songs probably actually are,
yeah,
you hear an eighth of every song. You know, they start and then you get it and then they cut away. So
right.
It's really about who they are to their fans and who they are as people. They are, and I think this is true with a lot of bands like this, these are really bright, smart, interesting people. I thought the rest of the band actually was, to me, they focus on the singer because it's his story, but I found the rest of the band to be super compelling.
I did too. The Mark Morton, the guitar player who they went to a lot, who this has nothing to do with anything, just sidebar. When Mark Morton is just doing voiceover, his voice sounds exactly like David Cross's voice. Did
oh
you
my
ever
God,
notice
that's
that?
So funny. No,
it was
didn't.
So weird.
No, I didn't, but I really love David Cross's voice, so that's interesting.
Yeah.
That's why I liked him so much.
Yeah.
Yeah, that,
I mean,
once
you got back to his face, it was like that idea went away because it was so, you know.
Yeah.
It made no sense.
Yeah. Well, he looks like you know, they're from Richmond, Virginia, but they look like those kind of dudes. You know, they have that long hair, beards. Mm-hmm. You know,
they look the part.
Yeah, the big cutoff shorts. But they're down the road a bit now, and they're all like they have daughters,
men,
and they
yeah.
barbecue, and one of them drives a Prius, and they're really
oh
bright
my
guys.
God. What was the quote about? As everyone knows, real metalheads drive Priuses. Chris
yeah.
Adler, drummer.
Yeah.
Of Lamb of God.
Yeah. 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 They. Yeah,
that was fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
Seeing him loading his drums
into
the back of a Prius.
Yeah, and they're little girls
metalhead.
With their little pink bike helmets
oh
on,
my
and
God.
Like, yeah, yeah, and they're shooting baskets in the backyard, and just like most guys that are, you know, they
yeah,
get
most
to that.
40-year-old dudes who
right.
are like,
yeah. They
going to work. It's like daddy's got to go to work now.
Yeah, yeah,
but
yeah,
work
yeah.
is like angry that, double kick drum
hardcore touring. You know,
yeah.
they're doing those like, you know, those venues are probably 2,000, maybe more, maybe they're bigger. I don't know, but
I mean, some of those venues were like, I mean, I don't know if they were headlining, all of them, but like those outdoor festivals they were playing was like in other parts of the world where outdoor festivals are like really a thing.
Yeah.
Like South America, Europe.
Yeah.
Those places, I mean, they look like 50,000 people.
Right.
All jumping up and down and screaming and going crazy. It's like, it's powerful to see people responding to music like that.
Right.
It's really powerful.
Yes.
And
yes.
Those guys have, it seemed like the guys in Lamb of God had really thoughtful takes on what their fans, how their fans related to them and what their music meant to fans. And I think that, you know, Randy the singer even said, like, when I was young and I felt, you know, depressed or downtrodden, or, you know, I felt like
disconnected.
Yeah. That music was the thing that tethered me to the earth and made me feel like I was a part of something.
Yeah.
And so music to him, you know, he says music saved my life.
Do you have that relationship with music?
Sure. Although I kind of missed the punk boat. Some parts of Dorchester got the punk boat.
Yeah.
I did not.
But did it?
I got the disco boat straight to the Smiths.
Right. But did it connect? Yeah. Did you connect to it? Like, were you?
Yeah. Music like, was everything. Thing? Music was everything to me.
Yeah. It was everything.
Yeah.
And did you, and were like, because I'm older than you, like music when I was a kid, when I was in high school was still like it was counterculture. Like even having a guitar was like a, you know, Ted's brother has a guitar. He's in a band. Like it wasn't a thing that everybody did.
Right.
It was sort of outsider. You know, the guy back parking lot guys were the guys that started metal bands or played, you know, like guys that you were like, those guys get high. You know what I mean? Like, I was very square and suburban and like, you know, played sports but I was compelled, you know, I found once I got an Aerosmith record, I was like, oh my God, fucking yeah, please. There's nobody around here like this. Like I had that, like, those are my people. Guys that wear scarves and also have sex with girls. That's my, those are my people. That will not be a look for me.
That's so cool that you related to that.
No, totally. I was like, Steven Tyler was like a fucking, I was like, wait, I had no idea this was even a genre of man you could be. Like, we just, you know, it just was like.
And he was so unquestionably masculine.
There was no question about it.
Right.
Yeah. The only people that questioned it were people that probably were attracted to him. Like the only people that were angry about it were like, well, that covers too much for you. His lips are too big.
Right.
You know, but yeah, he was like, and I was like, oh my God, I had funneled so much of my identity into sports so that when that happened, it was late. I was like 18 years old.
Right.
But I just was like, oh my God, this is a relief, like a relief. Yeah. So I get that thing of like when people go, oh, those are my people. Now I got to get to them. I got to figure out how to.
Well, yeah.
You know,
and I remember when Run DMC came out and like hip hop culture and breakdancing and stuff, and we, like, our little enclave of misfits completely attached ourselves to that. So rap and hip hop was my punk rock, and that was like
right.
That was really dangerous music, really threatening music.
Yeah,
In our world. So it worked in the same way. And like I knew every word to every hip hop song and I just love that music. And it made me feel like I was, you know, it's an easy way to rebel without actually like doing drugs or running away from home or being truly bad. It was like a way to be bad without being bad.
Yeah, and
I was also so Catholic, so like in a rule follower, so I didn't want to be that bad.
That's so funny.
You know.
But it also, but at the time it did have, like I used to say, like it really was a battering ram. Like it really actually was an anti-establishment thing.
Yeah.
It did have that power to freak people out. I mean, when punk happened, I mean, I remember there being articles. I mean, I remember seeing it as a little kid and went, I don't know that seems wrong, but why
scared.
Would you put a pin in your face? Like those people seem messed up. Like it just really did seem like, you know, and also the world was skewed to be like, if you get high once, you'll probably end up a junkie.
Totally.
You know, that, so everything felt more dangerous.
Yep.
Which also made it more alluring, of course.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I can't tell because I'm not a kid, so I don't know that music has that same effect on kids, or that they see it that way as a place to go and make noise anymore, because the whole setup of this film is, here's this guy who found his life, who lived on the margins, but music sort of saved his life. But we find out pretty quickly and pretty early on that he had addiction problems.
Or when they start the tour, we don't know this until, you know, probably halfway into the movie.
Right.
Or a third of the way into the movie, that he has been sober for a year and a half.
Right.
And that his drinking nearly tore the band apart, you know, in
right.
prior tours. And people, what they say is that the band really started as like a drinking club, and they would all get together and party really hard. And I forget which one of them said it, but Randy's music always went to 11. Like, he was just always partying way past everyone else. And turning into a different person, getting in trouble. There's old footage of him actually ending up in an emergency room someplace, being attended to by a doctor, bleeding from the head, and like.
So the drunk footage of him is that kind of footage where, as a recovering alcoholic myself, like, I had some, like, there's always levels with people. But he goes to that place where it's amazing the band stayed together as long as it did, because he's such right. a dick immediately. You yep. know that guy.
Yep.
That guy has picked a fight with you at a bar for no reason. You wanted
that
someone to take
me.
That guy out. Is that you?
Yeah. I really loved bar fights.
Oh, my God.
That
that's hilarious.
That was like my favorite.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I wasn't always Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde. I wasn't always that yeah. way, but clearly he was.
Yeah.
And it caused tremendous problems within the band. So that's why they named the record Resolution, because it was like they resolved that
right.
part of their past. They're starting on this new tour, this world tour, and with Randy clean and sober. And he's talking about, it's so funny, there's a scene of them in Israel, and he's like floating on top of the Dead Sea, talking about sobriety and talking about how, you know, the first 7 months or so, he was just like a mess, and it was horrible, the most painful period of his life.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
now, a year and a half or two into it, he's feeling like he knows who he is, and he feels really solid, and this is how he wants to live.
Yeah, they show him at the Wailing Wall, right?
Yep.
And he's got
all that shit.
Yeah, and they also there was a really interesting part, they didn't focus on it, but I kind of liked it. That's why I wish they spent more time with the band, because I really found the other guys compelling. But they went, no, you don't necessarily, they're not friends of mine. Like, one guy was at, like, we're not friends, and the other guy was like, they're guys you can hang out with sometimes, like, and you forget about that sometimes. I think people, when, especially if you love a band or like that, you're like, they must be best friends, you know?
Right.
They have to like each other. And you're like, no, they don't.
They have to spend time apart in order to make it work.
Just to make it work.
Yeah.
And they don't necessarily even like each other on tour. And
right.
And there were guys that were in this that were like, they just avoided the subject of him. But you could also see, like, man, we can't go on tour without him.
Right.
And this is what I do.
And it seemed like everybody was like, really, even though, you know, it's like they're never going to be best friends, they're never going to be like, this is great, we're going on tour again, you know, it was painful for, you know, they show how painful it was for each of them to, like, you know, extricate themselves from their home lives and
right.
to go out and do this again.
Right.
But, you know, they're like, this is what we do.
This is what we do. Yeah, right.
And there was this one scene too, I don't want to forget about this, where they're in India and they have an interview with this girl from Mumbai, and she is in a taxi and she's listening, she's like watching clips of the band. I was assuming that she was like on her way to the concert. And it turns out she's actually on her way to band practice, and she's got a heavy metal band, a speed metal band, and she sings just like Randy Blythe.
Just like them.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
It's
and
so
she's, yeah.
fucking amazing.
That
like
was
this
actually
Indian
really.
Indian girl.
Yeah. Yeah.
From
yeah.
Mumbai.
Yeah. Yeah. And she's listening to him and she's singing his lyrics, and then she'll say one of
she's
his
like,
lyrics.
Oh. She's like, fuck.
Yeah. And then she's like, oh my God. And I mean, it's funny because, you know, as you know about lyrics, some of them are profound and some of them sound like, you know, boy poetry, like, you know, 15-year-old boy poetry. You know, I am forever into darkness. And you're like, well, right. okay, well, that seems like the first thing you'd write, but we'll rewrite that. and she goes, I'm forever into darkness. And then she goes,
she's like, Man, that's heavy.
It's heavy. You know, he's talking about
it. It depends on who's saying it.
And where you're from and what the words mean and the experience you've had in life. And Totally Into Darkness maybe experienced that, like, yeah, that's exactly it. But it was just funny when she repeats a line, like, you know, I was, after the Gaga one, I was like, we have to find the Spinal Tap moments, you know, like in the, like, what is, if are there any? You know, and that they sometimes were, that one made me laugh a little bit. And then the other one, when they were talking about being friends and the guy said, you know, some days you're like, who ate my last Hot Pocket? You know, and he's not kidding about it. Like, his face is like, did you, like, it's almost like, did you, the cameraman? Well, I'm actually asking about the Hot Pocket. I'm now pissed. Like, it's like, who took my last Hot Pocket? And I was like, man, your last Hot Pocket, I bet on the road sometimes, that's important.
It's really important.
Yeah, that's all you got.
And it's like, your shit is your shit. When you're on the road, it's like, don't, it's, even if it's not the last one, even if it's the third to last one,
right,
don't eat my fucking Hot Pocket. Don't drink my Tab.
My Tab.
Do not drink it.
I know. Oh my God, Tab, that's amazing. If somebody in a band had Tab, I'd be like, respect, dude. I don't even know. I mean, I'm almost about to give you my opinion of the movie because this is what happened during the movie. I could not pay attention to it.
Wait, what?
Yeah. Huh?
Who the what?
Lamb of God.
Lamb of God.
Yeah, I could not stay in.
Couldn't stay in?
I could not stay with it. So we'll talk about that. We got to get to the crux of it. But that's what I'm saying. What we're doing right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, you couldn't stay focused.
I couldn't.
Okay.
Until.
All right. So after they go to India and all that stuff happens and we see now how people, the crowds are passionate, scary, terrifying. Physical aspect of what these people go through at shows is just like they are giving everything in response to this band.
So if you would describe the crowd at a national show as like good Episcopalians,
sure,
these are the people that take the snakes out and shake on the floor. Right, these are people who give their body and their soul to this thing. Like there's not a person, and that's the thing that's always been sort of amazing about metal. If a band connects and continues to connect, people will give you their life. They will give it over to you. So they are kind of showing you. Look, these guys have almost absolute power in the room, and even the shots of moshing, it
like
doesn't look like a fight. It looks like a swarm, but it also it looks like it's an agreed upon. It is the shaking and the
vortex.
Yeah,
it's like it looks like the eye of a hurricane.
Yeah, it's release.
Nuts. I've never seen any. I don't think I've ever been to a metal show.
Yeah, they didn't show their Los Angeles show, where I'm sure people stood with their arms crossed and thought about whether this band was useful to them in any way going forward with their own careers.
So they after they leave India, they get on a plane and they land in Prague, and as they're landing, they see. You know, as they're telling the story later, they see what looks like SWAT, like an American SWAT team waiting for the plane to land. And they all individually were thinking to themselves, like, wow, there must be a criminal on our plane. Because it was so obvious that the police were like getting ready to come aboard.
Yeah, something was up.
The aircraft.
Right.
So as they're, you know, packing up to get off the plane, it becomes obvious that the police are coming for them.
For the band. So there's been they've not said this is going to happen in any way other than, you know, the premise of the movie, but there's nothing that leads up to this. Nothing has happened so far that we know of.
Right.
So.
I mean, this happens while they're making this documentary.
Right.
So, yeah, just like a regular tour documentary. So they charge Randy with manslaughter in the death of a fan. They say that he pushed a fan who had gained access to the stage. They say that Randy pushed him off. The kid hit his head and fucking died.
But not there. Everybody went home. Then he went home.
The kid got a headache.
Then eventually he went to the hospital maybe the next morning. And then he went into a coma and he died. So it's very sad.
Right.
I didn't mean to say that in such a like a...
He didn't just die right then. I mean, they didn't. The band like went on with their tour.
Everybody went on. Like,
and,
that's what
and
they
went
made,
home.
Yeah, they
like,
make
they
the point
never
that they closed
anything.
The venue. They got paid. Everybody clean. You know, there was no anything.
They had no idea.
And then they left the country for 2 years. This is returning 2 years later.
Yes.
So, as though they were like, well, let's not charge them anything. They're not going to come back. We'll wait till they come back and then we'll get them. So just keep your eye on their tour page.
Right.
One guy's job was every day go look at the, did you look at the Lamb of God tour page? No, I got it. Okay. No, there's, I got nothing yet. Okay, well, check again tomorrow. Okay, well. They've got a date. It's in 4 months. Get everyone dressed. So they put him in a room. Everybody's scared. No one's going on. And then they pull Randy out. And then they start asking the band about Randy's character.
Right.
What kind of a person is. And we've learned that Randy's only his recent past is one that he would be proud of. And right. They have lots of footage of him not being a very good, nice right. person. Like there's plenty of evidence to show you he's an irresponsible, mean drunk.
Yeah.
Who very easily could have pushed somebody off
yes, stage.
Hurt himself.
Right.
Like you realize they're setting you up the whole time. They're like, they've shown you everything that you could use as a case against him, because here we are as someone in a foreign country who is now under their rules.
And, good editing.
Right? Yeah. Yes. They set it up.
Gold star to the editor.
Right.
Building up a good story to like get us to this point.
Right. Well, that's where I couldn't tell. Anyway, let's get through it and then I'll tell you what my thought was. Because it still is good storytelling. So they get, so they can't get him out of jail right away. So the band has
to
go back.
They postbond at $200,000,
right.
Which should be enough to get him out, but they won't let him leave.
Won't let him leave.
They think he won't come back. So then they raise the bond to $400,000 and they still won't let him leave.
They're not going to let him back.
He's in jail for 38 days.
Right.
On this charge.
On this charge, which that's a lot of fucking time.
That is
on a murder that you're like, wait, what happened? Who did I kill? Like,
right.
Usually when you murder somebody.
And they're all devastated to find, I mean, if there's one thing that we've learned is that they really care about their fans.
100%.
A lot.
100%.
You know, they feel a great kinship with the people who come and see them play. So they're also dealing with this new information that one of their fans has died. And they're really pretty.
They're
super bummed about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, the bass player, for some reason, like, you know, they show pictures. They show some really funny pictures of them. Like at the beginning, they show them taking their very first photo as a band that they were going to take themselves.
So funny.
And it's out them in the snow on brick stairs, and they all look ridiculous.
Like, pine trees on the side.
They're all old kids, and now the bass player looks like an old wizard. His hair's all white. He's got these deep set blue eyes. He's got
kind of young. Like his skin looks young.
Yeah,
it was
right.
Only because of the wizard beard. And
the beard. Yeah. And he also has a low voice and he was very thoughtful. But they all seem like actually very sweet. For the kind of music they make, they really seem like sweet dudes.
Yeah.
Right. They even show sitting on this porch playing, you know, blues. You know, the good looking guys out there playing some sort of like pretty finger picking blues.
Oh my God, that was so fun. That all I could think of was like, this one's called Lick My Love Pump.
Right. 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 This is Festering Tumor off right. of Blood Nothing. everything turns to blackness. Fuck. Man, that happens. That's what death is. Right. But think of other, like, go past black. Like, think, let's. So anyway,
let's be creative here, guys.
Come on.
So that was sort of like the underscore for this talk, this introspective talk about what has just happened, what it means that, you know, like how fucked up it is that this has happened to Randy at this point in his life. I mean, everybody is kind of like reeling at the timing of this, that like Randy has just like gotten his life back together. And everyone's really proud of him. This should be like the, you know, this tour is going better than any other tour that they've ever done. But a lot of that is because, you know, the success of the album, but also because of Randy is like now a responsible partner in this endeavor, you know?
Right.
And so everybody is just kind of like, wow, this is not what we expected to happen.
Right.
And
is this going to put Randy... It's just going to set Randy off because as a, you know, it doesn't take much. Doesn't take much to put you back in that place.
Right.
And
especially at a year and a half of sobriety, that's like a very tenuous time.
Right. And this is a big, like, what he's being accused of. And then, you know, like in my mind, I'm like, oh, well, I get out tonight because I didn't do it.
Right.
And it would be circumstantial at best. But there's not even any proof that I have done it, you know, but. And now I'm in jail for 38 days.
Right.
So, everybody goes home. Then he gets released.
Yeah.
Right.
And they all meet him at the airport. There's tears and like, and now I think, everybody feels a great sense of gratitude about what they have, but it's still not over. Randy has to go back to the Czech Republic to go on trial. But before that happens, they go to Iowa to play on the fucking Slipknot Festival.
The Slipknot Festival. Slipknot
Festival. Which is like, wow.
Yeah. Right. Slipfest? Slipknot Festival. So they have like, they're from, what is it, Ohio? They're from, where was it? Oklahoma. Slipknot.
Slipknot's from Iowa, I think.
Iowa, yeah, right.
So and they're playing in Iowa.
Yeah.
That's where the big show
they have a two-day
is.
Festival. One day's in Iowa and the other one is somewhere else, but close.
In the heartland.
Yeah. Right. And then they have, and in the movie, like, you know, Slash talks about the band, and Corey from Slipknot, who is a talented guy, he talks about the band. And they had a little they raised money for the legal fees while he was in
and like
incarcerated.
Everyone from Ozfest
Sharon Osbourne got involved because there was an opportunity to, and she was able to be a part of it. And
because let's not forget the Lamb of God, not rich,
touring band
band. They all make a living. A bunch of other people, you know, they're like crew. Everyone makes a living, but no one's rich off this thing.
Right.
And they can't afford legal fees that come with defending someone from a murder charge.
Right. And I don't think they're on my guess is if they're smart, they're not. They're not on a huge label. Right. I don't think they're on a big, powerful label if there is such a thing anymore.
Actually, that was a funny little factoid.
Oh, Epic. Right.
That when they first started out, they were on Prosthetic Records, which I thought was just
amazing.
An unreal name for, I mean,
Prosthetic.
What a fantastic name for a label.
Yeah. So then they play a couple shows, and then, it seemed to me like he either was let go. So they don't tell you why they decided to let him go or whether he was let go but had to come back, because I felt like their whole thing of not letting go is that he didn't have to come back, which I don't think
they have to. They didn't cover the deal. Well, I mean, I think that he did have to come back because countries have like extradition treaties with each other,
right.
And he would have the full force of the American government come down on him if he did not go back to the Czech Republic, because I don't know what I'm talking about.
It seems like he would have chosen to go back even if, like, I think they're trying to make the point that he was had integrity and wanted to go back and sort of answer to the.
So here's something that was not in the movie, but is a fact. Mm. So he was arrested in June of 2012, held for 38 days, was able to go back to the States, and then his trial started in Prague, February 2013. So this didn't last quite as long as you would have thought. I mean, it didn't drag out for an interminable amount of time.
Right. And then he goes back, and so there's sort of like this, but he keeps... This is where they start to lose me.
Do you feel like that they were cherry picking quotes and ideas and sort of thought processes that were meant to manipulate you?
I kept thinking, when did this take place? When did they record this? Are they acting out this scene, or how are they in the manager's office when he was in? He's yelling at somebody on the phone, giving exposition, saying, "I got a guy who's in jail for, you know," like he's telling it as though it had just happened.
Right.
But
it probably
hadn't.
Did.
I couldn't. Something about this felt to me like it had been manipulated, or like there was voiceover that came later, like, or things were re-recorded, or he kept stacking the deck against himself as though he knew he was making a documentary about this. And so, and he had a camera on him when he walked out of the courthouse. Like, there were just some moments I went, I'm feeling manipulated. And I don't know why.
Right.
Because I'm not normally that cynical. I started to kind of lose interest during this, which I felt like I shouldn't, because this seems
this is like the coming to the climax of the film.
Yeah.
Which is like, does he spend the rest of his life in a Czech prison, or does he get to come home?
Right. And I kept feeling like he was indicating to us more that he thought he would, because he goes, it's probably going to be 0 to 6 years. It's going to be something. I think they're going to.
Right. As soon as he started talking that way, and they started, because we knew certain things from like the footage, for example, that was completely contradicted by some of the witnesses.
Right. So, so the way they set it up is they show you in the court part of the case.
They set it up in a way that was just like, oh, now we're being played.
So what they do is, in the court case, the evidence against him, they have footage of a guy jumping off the stage three times.
Which is Daniel which is, you know, which is they're saying is Daniel Nosek,
right,
which was the young man who died.
Right. First time he throws himself off the stage. The second time he runs by, is sort of pushed by the security guard, and you can tell that Randy puts his hand out as well, but almost to just keep him from hitting him. And then the other time, the guy's pulled off by a security guard, smacks his head on the side of the monitor, falls on the ground, right? So you're like, okay.
It's a little damning, but not necessarily towards Randy.
Certainly not. Randy's not even in the footage there. So the
second time, it could be said that Randy participated in that.
And the point that the guys in the band keep making, which is true, they're like, look, a fan of ours died at one of our shows, or was
like
because of our show, because of their enthusiasm, they're dead.
Right.
And that's just difficult if you have fans at all to have one, you know, right? So that but I felt when the other guys in the band said it, I felt it more in my heart.
Right.
Than in this story, which I felt like is being used to sell the idea of this.
So then, towards the end of the trial, or was it? Now that you're calling all of this timeline into question, I was buying it, that the timeline was the timeline. Sort of like at the end of the trial,
right?
A fan of the band sees the press coverage and recognizes himself as the man in all of these film clips of this guy being thrown off stage. They've been saying that it's the murdered fan,
right?
But it's not. The person that they're showing in these film clips is alive and walks among us.
Which is some super hinky police work to me. It's like, what?
Well, it was a prosecutor. The prosecutor clearly had some political ambitions, whatever it was.
Right.
That he thought that if he could get a big American rock star convicted of murder, then he could go on to be, you know, run the fucking school board and whatever it was that he wanted to do.
Right. So that also, that information was like, we didn't profile that guy. We didn't get any information about the court case.
No.
I sort of felt like, okay, this whole thing hinges on a court case that we really, what you're saying right there is like that piece of information is skimmed over at best. So then you find out it's not our guy, it's another guy, right? And this guy's like, oh no. And he goes, I put myself up there on purpose. You run and you jump off the stage is what you do. And, you know, in the case, they show different examples of people jumping off. They have to explain what moshing is to the jury. So they show people at a Nirvana concert.
It's not a jury,
concert.
It's just three judges.
I mean, the remember? Judges, right. Yeah. The jumping off the at Nirvana concerts. Like they sort of give you the history of moshing.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
Because who would understand? It doesn't make any sense.
Right.
If you're like an old Czech judge.
Right.
Like, why are these people behaving this way?
Right. But also, as any kind of a judge, it's like, how can we even, like, even if that's a part of the culture, it's going to be very hard to convict. Like, that this got to trial at all, to me, feels hinky.
Of course.
Because I think it's super clear.
It's so shady. Because why didn't anybody ever know that before they, like, landed in Prague 2 years later?
Right. And then
that's messed up.
So then the last witness is the uncle.
Yes.
And
that
he says,
was really upsetting, actually.
But he says, I don't think Randy's completely at fault.
Right.
But my sister will never see her son again.
Right.
And she's also not doing well either.
Right.
And I think, wait, are you just... Did you do your shakedown wrong? You should have shook down the venue. Like, I feel like he's a shit. Like, so
right.
now I've been, so my fucking cynicism, having done my only court, I was on a jury this year for the first time in my life. I'm like, this is a shakedown. That guy talked to, he's like, your son died. We, you know, go after the band, someone with all the money, not the venue. They don't know. I felt like it was a shakedown. So that way, and then I'm like, why aren't we telling that story? Because that's what that guy seemed like full of shit at the end. My sister she's not doing well. Okay, we need help for her. She's having mental problems.
But I think you're viewing this through the lens of the American justice system, which the Czech justice system clearly is not.
Right. No, no, no. Of course.
I mean, just the fact that there's no jury, but in America, I think you can do that. Like you can, you know, sue in like civil court after this whole kind of dog and pony show is over or whatever. But I don't know. I felt like that was just like a normal witness impact statement that was meant to you know, just be another thing to consider for the judges.
Could have been. It could have been.
Right. Or it could have been a shakedown. But we just don't know what that justice system is like, I guess. Can you even do that?
I don't know. Right. And then they were talking about why weren't there, how come they didn't have 5 foot from the stage? There should have been a...
Because it's not Iowa at the Slipknot show. You know, it's like, that's why there's not.
Right, because they don't
do
that.
Because they just don't have the same shit there.
Right, and people run and jump off the stage all the time, and that's what concerts have been for a long time.
Because the security's terrible, so a fan can easily do that. In this case, 3 times. Not the dead boy, but a different fan.
Right.
Went up on stage 3 times.
Right.
Unstopped by security.
Right.
Yeah.
So then... He gets off.
Total exoneration.
Total exoneration, which is what he was saying. Probably something's going to happen. There's going to be some lesser thing or nothing at all.
Right.
Nothing at all, because this is not really, it wasn't really, if anything, he should have been, the 38 days in jail. That was unfair.
They should have given that back to him.
Right. Right. And then we talk about how great, you hear the band talk about how he really, you know, he's changed, and he held it together during the trial, and yet no one seems that excited to see him at band practice. So I...
Well, some time must have passed or something, or...
Yeah, the only guy that seems really... There's 2 guitar players. There's the guy that you and I are both in love with who played blues on his porch.
Yes.
And basketball with his little girl, Mark.
Mark Morton.
And then there's
who's also the film composer. Did I mention that to you?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
He's the film composer.
Oh, okay. He's like, if I'm going to be a part of this, I want something out of it, because I've never liked Randy.
He was like oddly attractive.
He's the fucking star of the thing. They should have gone back to him and the Wizard. But they,
a lot, right?
And the drummer actually was kind of cool too. And very talented.
They all were really cool. I loved them all.
And then the one guy in the band that probably is the guy that had to argue every time they were going to throw Randy out, which is the other guitar player, the sort of smaller,
was it the bass
round face guy? No, the bass player is the Wizard.
Oh, right, right, right.
The more round-faced guy.
Right, I know. The one who cried at the airport.
Yes. No one else. They don't even show anybody else.
And they show the Wizard at the airport.
Yeah, they show him at the airport, but they don't show any of them hugging.
The other guitar player was crying.
Yeah, so they show them at the airport, but 2 of the guys that are at the airport seem like they're like, I guess we should be here. And like when they had the march for him, or like people, there were like 3 people with signs that were like, let Randy go. And then like they walked in front of the camera, and then there were not a, like it, there were things I felt like got ramped up.
Were staged?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know.
Really?
I feel like such a bad person, but I really just did not.
Do you feel
not.
Like a bad person because you can see the pain in my face as you're saying this?
Yeah. I like it when we agree, Kay. I'm just way too codependent for that. But I tried really hard to stay in on this thing, and by the end I was like, hey, I don't know. I did not buy it.
All right.
I mean, it was real what happened.
I bought it hook, line, and sinker.
You do.
I did. I do. I mean, now I have some questions. You have raised some valid suspicions.
So this I didn't want to say at the beginning because I wanted to like hear. So I'll.
You didn't want to derail my enthusiasm.
Yeah, you and I also said to Rick, I'm like, you know, when Kate says things, a lot of times I change my mind completely. Like she'll say something, I'll go, oh no, you're right. I didn't think about that. So I want you to say what you think, and then because I have one card to play, I think would be interesting. But go ahead and
what am I rating?
Tell me
it?
What you know, but tell me what you like.
What I thought about the movie in its totality.
Yeah,
I loved it. I enjoyed it a lot. I loved all the people in it. I thought that that the filmmaking, I really liked it.
Here's
I bought it.
You bought it.
I didn't actually physically buy it. I rented it, right. But I bought it.
But you went with it. You like Randy.
I was there.
You,
I was in it.
You were in it.
Yeah.
So I started watching it, and I realized that I wanted to write something down, so I restarted it. So at the beginning, Randy is walking you.
Like in a real,
they show you some beautiful shots of Richmond, but they show you, you know, the sort of industrial and rivers and that kind of stuff, and they show you this place by the water where he had to live during certain parts of his life where he was homeless. So, and you get to meet him, and the second he starts talking, he's got that very kind of cool, flat, half Midwestern, Southern, East, like that whole, he's got that guy. Like you hear him talk and you go, I fucking know that dude. That right. dude's hilarious. The second time I watched it, I'm looking at it. I'm like, what is it? So he's talking about being sober, and he's got him like a travel mug of what I assume is coffee. But in all of his pockets are beers. In all of the pockets in his jacket are beers, which I didn't notice the first time I saw it. So I'm like, okay, maybe he brought them for the, I don't know. Now I'm thinking about that. Then when they're at the airport, the guy says, I got some something and some beers for him. And I'm
some
like,
NA well. Beers.
Oh, he says NA beers.
Yes.
Oh, he said NA beers.
Yep.
All right, maybe they were NA beers.
Which is weird. Anyway.
Something about it, something about him made me go, I don't trust this. There's something I don't, there's something missing for me. There's a piece that's, like when Judas Priest went on trial for just their lyrics, I felt their pain. Like when they all walked in, I'm like, these guys are suffering. This is a bummer. They seem like nice people. Now they've got to, now they've got to not be in their ridiculous outfits that they know were kind of silly and they're wearing suits, but they do believe in what they're doing and they didn't want the kid to die. But I felt like this has stakes where I was like, how am I missing the stakes from this? I don't feel it. And I don't feel everyone in the band is like, yeah, we just flew back.
Like you think that they should be more upset or more like...
If we did our podcast on the road and we got off a plane and you got arrested, I'd stay in town until you were released.
Right.
Like,
that's
I'd be like,
true.
We should be here till Kay. And I was like, maybe they have to go back or they can't afford to stay or something. But
yeah,
a couple of guys seem like, yeah, I mean, I feel bad for him. I don't. Do we have to do this?
Whoa.
So okay. I can't tell.
Right.
I can't tell.
Okay.
I could also be cynical.
I think I didn't really think that that was so unusual because
right.
how could they stay in Prague for 38 days?
That's true.
While he's in prison, they
that's
don't
true.
Know how long he's going to be there.
Right.
And he'll, you know, I didn't really, I mean, the not, when he said that he brought the beers to the airport.
Yeah.
And then I realized that he meant non-alcoholic beer.
I
was just like,
okay.
Oh, I mean, I was bummed mostly for him that he was drinking.
Yeah.
Non-alcoholic beer. Cause that's really disgusting.
That's nowhere to go.
Bam, that's bam. A slog, man. I just
yeah. That's but that to me like that there's something about the and look, I'm in no place to judge anybody about anything, but I was just like, what am I genuinely feeling from this? Because I was the one that saw this. Somebody had posted it, and of course, we'd love to hear what you're thinking. If you're a Lamb of God fan, you might know more about the band than me. But there was something disingenuous about it.
Hmm.
I felt like, and different than the. Strangers.
Their family dynamic is just, they're not codependents like we are.
That's
they're
true.
They're able to unplug from each other. They're able to disconnect with love.
Right. And just because a bad thing happened to somebody, they still have a track record of years of not being, you know, awesome. So you don't have to be that overwrought
yeah.
that they're in jail.
They're not best friends.
And maybe this would just be a solid ending to the band anyway. And then we wouldn't have to have that meeting where we throw them
but
out.
But they seem sufficiently thoughtful about the whole situation, I thought.
They seemed about it when they were asked about the fan, because at the end of the day, the one thing for sure is somebody went to their show and then died afterwards.
Right.
At some point.
They all seemed very moved by that fact.
Of course,
yeah.
As you would be, right?
And I think it spoke a lot about them as people. Like, I mean, you're right. I didn't understand their dynamic, but I don't understand anyone. I mean, like, I see families of all different, you know, I don't understand other people's families. The way people interact with each other,
100%.
The way people show their love or withhold it, whatever it is, whatever your thing is, whatever your family dynamic is, it's like, it's a fucking snowflake.
No, it is true. And it is like, in especially in these relationships, like even in other bands where you're like, that guy died and you didn't call him. And it's like, yeah, we don't really like each other. Like we do this thing together. So I made assumptions about you because I need you to be a family or I need to believe in this thing or you
right.
must all believe. And it's like, you know, the people are like, I've never listened to Tommy Stinson's. Like, I don't even know the lyrics. He's the greatest.
Right.
Just power. He stands right. And he's like, but yeah, of course,
you
I get it.
You played these songs 200 times. Do we want to talk about our rating scale? Do you have anything else to say about Lamb
of God? No, I think I said it.
Palaces burn.
Yeah. I mean, I do I like where we just got to the part about like what the identity of a band is supposed to be. Because that,
right.
I guess, is the thing that popped up for me. And I kept watching this thing going, what is driving this thing? What
yeah.
story are we telling? Who am I feeling for? And also, why am I, maybe I'm overthinking it because I don't apply
right.
that pressure to, I certainly didn't to the 7 hours I was in Blade Runner the other night. I didn't apply a lot of pressure to that. And I, you know, I'm still there, I believe. And I just let it happen. I let it happen to me. I was like, I'm going to let that go. Doesn't matter. Still love it. Still enjoying it. even though the person I brought with me is like, this seems long. You know, I only apply it to certain things, but I wanted to like this. Really, like when I saw the trailer,
so
I thought.
So did you just hate it?
I didn't hate it, but I felt manipulated by it.
Wow, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
3.5 Tufnels for me.
3.5?
No. 3.
3 Tufnels?
3 Tufnels.
Yeah, I give it 2 just because the guys in the band are super compelling. And right. also, on the side, I think they're good at what they do. I think their music's awesome. Like, right. I think for that kind of, for what that sounds diminishing, reductive. It's good music.
Yeah.
You know, and they're talented. They're definitely talented. Yeah. So, all right. All right. And, I guess that's it, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I am Kay Hanley.
Yeah, I'm Greg Barron. This has been
Rock Out
with your Doc Out.
Yes.
Yeah. We'll see you next week.
Yeah. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Privilege, a chosen few. Blessed with our time in hell. Witness the divine vision.